The concept of work is very important in physics, and it's important and laborious in everyday life too. But in physics, work intimately connects two deep ideas that radical physics has already explored: force and energy. You remember, I hope, that force is just a push or a pull. We define it that way in Radical Physics Episode 4, RP4, and we described its international unit, the Newton. In RP10, we introduced the joule as the international unit of energy, and we defined energy to be... I never did define energy, did I? I said that we'd get to know energy through exposure, kind of a social definition. Well, here is a valuable bit of exposure. Work is the transfer of energy from one object to another by means of a force. Said differently, a force does work when it transfers energy from one object to another. Notice that, strictly speaking, forces do work, not objects. So we'll talk about the work done by gravity or friction or contact force and so on. Let's begin to be precise about the definition of work by saying this: work is force times distance through which that force acts. And let's be modest at first by considering motion in just one dimension, that is, motion in a straight line. Once we understand work in a straight line, then maybe in another video, we can expand to real 3D space. But the one-dimensional definition will still be very useful. Naturally, work is symbolized with a capital W. So our beginning definition of work is written this way. Capital W is defined as F times D. Remember that triple bar equal sign means is defined as, and tells us to pay close attention. After all, we're working on a useful definition of capital W, of work. If we don't get the very meaning of work right, then we're bound to have trouble later on. Definitions are important. I have left spaces after the F and the D because this initial definition is incomplete. I'll come back later and put some subscripts on the F and the D in order to get the definition of work fully right. But let's use what we've got now in a simple example. Let's see how much work gravity does on this kilogram when it falls through a distance of 1 meter. Notice that the motion is indeed one-dimensional, vertical. Our preliminary definition of work says that capital W is defined as F times D. Here, F is the force of gravity on the kilogram, that is, its weight, little w. And D is the distance through which the force acts. Let's follow the standard format for solving a problem in physics. First, we assign variables to the so-called given quantities. These are the quantities that we think will be relevant. Mass m equals 1 kilogram. Distance d equals 1 meter. We want to find the work done by gravity. Capital W sub g equals what? Now we guess which formulas are going to be useful. Capital W is defined as F times d. F equals F sub g, that is weight, which equals m times g, the acceleration due to gravity. Finally, we do mathematical work to combine formulas, and at the very end, plug in numbers and units. W is defined as F times d, which equals mgd. Finally, plugging in numbers and units, we get capital W sub g equals 1 kilogram times 10 meters per second per second times 1 meter, which equals 10 kilograms times meters squared divided by seconds squared. Evidently, the force of gravity did 10 units of work on the kilogram as a kilogram fell through a distance of 1 meter. That's the answer. But what are those complicated units? We've seen a subset of those units before. We encountered a kilogram meter per second squared when we first studied Newton's second law and the force of gravity. It's the Newton. Sure, on Earth, the weight of a 1 kilogram mass is roughly 10 newtons. But here we have the Newton multiplied by the meter. Evidently, the unit of work is the Newton times the meter. Yes, the SI unit of work is the Newton meter, force times distance. And that unit pops up so often that it deserves its own name. The Newton times the meter is called the joule. Aha! Now we know how the unit of energy is defined in terms of the fundamental units. 1 joule is defined as 1 newton meter, which equals 1 kilogram meter squared per second squared. Work, like energy, is measured in joules, and a joule is a newton meter. When a force of 1 newton acts through a distance of 1 meter, that force of any type does 1 joule of work. Let's do another example. Let me simply lower this kilogram through a distance of 1 meter. Now we see that 2 forces are involved. The force of gravity still acts downward, but now my contact or support force is pushing upward. Even though the mass is going down, I'm pushing up. Since 2 forces act on the object as it moves through a distance, 2 different calculations of work can be performed. We need to calculate the work done by gravity and, separately, the work done by my support force. But we already know how much work was done by the force of gravity. We did that calculation just moments ago. The presence of a support force does not change the work done by gravity. Capital W sub g equals F sub g times d equals mgd equals 1 kilogram times 10 meters per second per second times 1 meter equals 10 joules, just as before. Gravity does the same amount of work when I lower the mass slowly as when I just let it fall. But what about the work done by the support force, W sub S? Capital W sub S equals F sub S times D equals what? Can you see how to determine the support force F sub S? If I lower the mass at constant speed, then there's no acceleration. And so by N2, Newton's second law, A equals F sub net divided by M, the net force divided by the mass, that is 0, no acceleration, equals F sub net divided by M. So 0 equals the sum of the 2 forces, F sub G plus F sub S. The net force must be 0 because the mass is not accelerating. But if the net force is 0 and gravity still acts, then the support force must be just the negative of the force of gravity. F sub S equals minus F sub G equals negative 10 newtons. That negative sign just means that the force of support upward is opposite to the direction of motion, downward. But that's very significant. Look what happens when we return to our calculation of the work done by the support force. Capital W sub S equals F sub S times D equals negative 10 newtons times 1 meter equals negative 10 joules. The support force does negative 10 joules of work. In fact, whenever the force and the distance, more properly called the displacement, are in opposite directions, the work done by that force is negative. The idea of negative work turns out to be very useful. One of the key lessons of Radical Physics Episode 4A, RP4A, was that definitions must be useful. Sure enough, and please trust me on this for the time being, this definition of work that allows negative work to be done by a force is useful. Let's pause here to review. In one dimension, we've defined work to be force times distance. Capital W is defined as F times D. We've seen that work is measured in joules, newtons times meters. And we've seen that work is negative when F and D, force and displacement, are in opposite directions. But what about those initial gaps left just behind the F and the D? Here's the final, complete definition of work. Capital W is defined as F sub AV times distance sub parallel lines. As you might guess, F sub AV is the average force that acts, in case the force varies. And distance sub parallel lines is the component, that is the portion, the fraction of the displacement that is parallel to the force. To grasp these two ideas, those two subscripts, completely, requires more time than we have in this video. Instead, let's understand the relationship between work and another important physics concept, power. The power of a force is defined to be the rate at which that force does work. Symbolically, capital P is defined as capital W divided by delta T, the elapsed time. Again, in words, power is the rate of doing work. If the force that's doing the work varies over time, then the power of that force will vary too. In that case, our definition gives the average power. Capital P sub AV is defined as capital W divided by delta T. Let's do an example. How powerful is your pull-up force if you do one pull-up each second? Suppose M equals 50 kilograms, so you weigh about 500 newtons, or 110 pounds on Earth. G equals 10 meters per second per second. D equals 0.5 meters, half a meter, or less. P sub AV equals what? P sub AV is defined as W divided by delta T. W is defined as F sub AV times D parallel, lines parallel, and F sub G equals MG. P sub AV is defined as W divided by delta T, which is F sub AV times D divided by delta T. That's MGD over delta T. Now, plug in numbers and units. 50 kilograms times 10 meters per second times 0.5 meters divided by 1 second. Dealing with the numbers is easy. We get 250. But the units are gnarly. This complex unit of power must, by the definition of power, be the unit of work divided by the unit of time. Work is measured in joules and time in seconds. So power is measured in joules per second. That's called a watt. Your pull-up power is about 250 watts. Do you remember our early description of the joule as the energy of one handshake? Well, if you shake your hand up and down once every second, then your handshake power is about 1 watt. That's a nice image to remember. Handshake power is roughly 1 watt. And pull-up power, depending on your weight, of course, is about 250 times greater. Hey, but wait a minute. Doesn't your pull-up force do negative work during the downstroke of each pull-up? And wouldn't that mean that the total muscle work for each complete pull-up is plus 250 joules on the way up and negative 250 joules on the way down, giving a net or total muscle work of 0 joules per pull-up? No way. Our definitions of work and power are correct and useful, but it's tricky to apply them to something as complex as the human body. We'll have fun doing so, however, when we look at the physics of exercise and sports in a coming video.